Ricky Baker, where art thou? Where's Ricky? Are you in the sanctuary? Come on up. Hey, guys, he was baptized several weeks back, and we want to give him our certificate of baptism. Congratulations. Here you go. All right. That is what we're about, winning people to Jesus Christ and baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, no pressure. The most difficult message that I will bring in my lifetime probably today. This is the meat and potatoes of what I started last week. How many of you are a little bit excited about hearing God's word on the subject? Okay, yeah. I put it in writing, so you can take it with you. Hopefully you'll take a lot of notes. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of room for you to take notes on the notes, but there's a lot of scripture there. And I want to say real quickly, just right up front, you know, you have a responsibility. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, the authority is the inerrant, infallible, inspired word of God. So I desire with all my heart to place myself under the authority of the scriptures. And I want to be under the authority of the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. And I promise you a lot of agony, that's the right word, has gone into the preparation of this message. And just really a mantra of mine has just been, Lord, please don't allow me to get this wrong. I want to get this right. I want it to be what you want for us, what we need right now in terms of applying your word. And I believe that what I'm going to present to you today lines up with a rightly divided Bible, a rightly divided word. You know, it's real easy to pick and choose verses just to kind of meet what we want it to say. And if you take a verse out of context, I mean, you can pretty much make a verse say anything you want. There's thousands of them in here. We don't build doctrine on a single verse here or even four or five passages. We build sound doctrine on the whole of God's word, the whole of God's word, his teaching on a matter. Amen? Amen? And so that's my heart, my desire today is to bring glory and honor to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Would you hold your Bibles up if you believe it is God's word? And let's do our biblical affirmation. I believe the Bible is God's word.
I believe the Bible is God's word.
Inerrant, infallible, inspired, authoritative, relevant. I will, by God's grace, obey it and apply it to my life today. Amen. All right, if you would, open your Bibles up to Romans chapter 13. This is actually going to be the last message for right now in that series that I've been doing for a while in the book of Romans. And Romans chapter 13, and those first few verses, a lot of misunderstanding has come from this text. A lot of abuse of power has been generated from this text. So questions of what legitimate or illegitimate authority is, and when should we obey, and when or when we should resist, it's been wrestled with since the dawn of human history. You know, our very own founding fathers wrestled with these questions when they were trying to decide whether it was right before God to rebel against the tyrannies of King George II. They wrestled with it. They drew an incredible amount of discernment from pastors of the day. And one of the pastors was the Reverend Dr. Mayhew. And they actually retrieved a motto or a slogan from him. But I'm going to quote that a little bit later. The founding fathers have been called by some as rebellious and going against God. when they rebelled against King George. And I want to very definitively and openly and boldly proclaim, as a pastor and as a student of history and as a student of the Word, I believe that they were right in the center of God's will. I believe the founding of this nation was truly directed by God Himself. And I think we can find some insight, most importantly from God's Word, but also from our godly founding fathers. You know, a lot of those early powerful leaders, by the way, were pastors. And if you'll look at the history, you'll notice that a lot of them stepped forward and they took leadership, bold leadership, in what God was doing. You know, the idea that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that was foreign to so many that had come over from England. I mean, they knew it deep, deep down inside, but that had been suppressed. And yet our founding fathers, finding great inspiration from the Word of God, decided to take a stand that all men are created equal and that they're endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. In the original drafts, it was life, liberty, you ready, and private property. And it wasn't the pursuit of happiness. And I think that's really important for us to understand that from a biblical point of view, there are inalienable rights that's given us: life, liberty, and private property. And because our founding fathers, I think, didn't put that in, it's created a lot of problems for us now as a country, with a lot of our elected officials not understanding that socialism is evil, that socialism is from hell itself, and socialism basically doesn't get it right, the whole issue of private property, right? And then let me blow you away with something, but I believe that the concept, the inalienable right of private property, we get our sense of privacy from that. We get our sense of autonomy from Almighty God to choose what we are going to do in this human body while we're here 70, 80, 90, 100 years on this planet. It has everything to do with spheres of authority and what these spheres of authority say to you or to me as individuals created in the image of God and given certain rights that no sphere of authority has the right to overrun. So let's look at that text quickly, if you would. Well, let me finish the intro. I'm going to give you a contrast in the intro. So our founding father, well, first of all, let me take a poll. How many of you believe our founding fathers got it right and rebelled against King George II? Can I see your hands? Yeah, I think so. So unfortunately, the people of Hitler's Germany at that time answered these questions wrongly. And as a result of answering the question wrongly of legitimate or illegitimate authority, 6 million plus Jews were murdered, died horrific deaths. The world was plunged into a bloody world war. I want us to get it right now as Christians. I want us to get it right. I mean, I'm a citizen, most important, of the kingdom of Christ, but I'm also a citizen of these United States, and I'm proud of it. I want to get it right now, because I think we're at a turning point. And so this message today, I believe, is purely from God's word. Look at Romans 13, verses 1 and 2. I just want to remind everybody, this needs to be out. It's the drum I beat last week, but I want you to look at verses 1 and 2. Every person, the Apostle Paul said, under the inspiration of God, is to be in subjection to the governing authorities. For there's no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. Therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation. The Apostle Peter addresses it in 1 Peter 2. The word of God is full from cover to cover with this idea. God has established several institutions of legitimate authority which every person is to obey. I'm not above it. You're not above it. Kings are not above it. Anybody familiar with the concept of lex rex? The law is king. And we would say, as God's created, God's law is king. Amen? Above all rule, above all authority, God's law reigns supreme. But make no mistake, God is for authority. God institutes authority. He's instituted, as I talked about last week, but now you have it in your notes, he's instituted the institution of the family authority. That is the most basic, beyond your own individual authority God's given you over your own person. God has an institution of the family where you have a husband, you have a wife. God blesses, you've got kids. So then there's a father and there's a mother and there are children. And the father is to lead his children in such a way, not to sandpaper them, not to grind in, but to lead with loving truth in the home. The mother is to do the same, and the children are to obey dad and mom. Do I hear a witness and amen from parents? There's an institution of authority of the family. If you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
It's important. It's a sphere of authority. The second sphere of authority is that of civil authority. Government, state government. Folks, we need authority, because last time I looked, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And that includes me, that includes you, that includes 8 billion people on the planet, that includes everybody that's ever lived except the God-man Jesus. And so we need authority. We need civil authority. Let me say it again. We need civil authority. The other institution is the institution of the church authority. And I've listed references there for you. Jesus Christ himself said, "The gates of hell will not prevail against my church." There's a sphere of authority. Pastor, elders are in authority in the local church. And Peter gives the exhortation to pastors in chapter 5. Do not use your authority in an abusive way, an abrasive way, in a domineering way. But what I want you to do is to lead your family, your church family, pastors, with a spirit of humility and with the best interest of the body of believers at heart. And so there's the institution of church authority. If you turn the page in your notes, now we get to the point of the message today. God prescribes what is legitimate authority, what it's to look like, and by contrast, what illegitimate authority looks like. First of all, let me just take a poll. Do you agree with the concept that there's legitimate and there's also illegitimate authority? Do you agree with that? Let me see your hands. Okay. About 80% in Germany did not really understand that. Okay, so Romans chapter 13, verses 3 and 4. These verses are conveniently excluded from the pulpits. They were conveniently excluded from the pulpits in England by the state church, by the state-sponsored King George II blessed pastors that could speak and could run the state-organized church. These verses were excluded. Look at what God is saying. He is defining what is legitimate authority here. And I'm going to argue by contrast what is illegitimate authority. So look at it. Verse 3. For rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what's good, and you will have praise from the same. For it's a minister of God to you for good. But if you do what is evil, be afraid. For it does not bear the sword for nothing. For it is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil. Let's dissect what is the difference between legitimate authority and, by contrast, illegitimate authority, and what the difference is in the response of people pursuing good and the response of people pursuing evil to legitimate and illegitimate authority. You ready? Test it. Good people are not afraid of legitimate authority, but evil people are. That's God's plan. Do you agree with that? Amen. Good people are afraid of illegitimate authority, but evil people are not. I have a confession to make. I truly was scared. It was Easter Sunday following the start early on of the pandemic. And I know that our county judge, the Honorable Chris Hill, got it right when he talked about every Texan's essential, and he wisely pulled 200 of us pastors together, and he had us meet with the health officials. I thought it was a brilliant, brilliant use of state governing resources and state authority. But Chris did not lead the county to overstep their sphere of authority, their civil sphere of authority, because he knew when he gathered those 200 pastors, he was now meeting with representatives who were over another sphere of authority. If you were listening, what sphere of authority? The church. So Chris Hill, being an honorable man, a righteous man, I don't mind saying that, he came out and he did not try to shut down churches or anything. There was there was a city in close proximity to our county church. We're in the county, we're governed by the county, but there was a city, and the head of that city, the leader of that city, had made it clear to the pastors of the churches, you will shut down, and to business owners, you will shut down, and it was pretty much a strong lockdown. And I was really nervous because of the close proximity of that city. I was afraid that that leader of that city would confuse our church and think that somehow we were under his jurisdiction of authority, when in reality, we were in Collin County, okay? Does that make sense? I really was afraid because, number one, we never stopped meeting. And I don't care how scared I was, we were gonna obey Christ rather than the government, right? Amen? So that we resisted, I guess. That would be a good example of it, right? Amen? Glory to God. So on that Easter Sunday, you know, I mean, we were smart about it. We were in cars. Do y'all remember that? By the way, what I want for Pastor's Appreciation Sunday, it's coming up. I don't want any money. I don't want you to send me an Angela to Hawaii or Israel or... Here's what I want. I want us to have a recreation of us obeying Christ as opposed to a governing authority that was potentially overstepping. I want us to have a drive-in worship service. What do you think of that? Would that be cool? But we won't separate the cars 6 feet apart like we did way back. But wouldn't that be fun? We might need to expand the parking lot. We've gotten a little bigger. Okay, so anyway, look, good people are afraid of illegitimate authority, but evil people are not. I was afraid that this governing official was going to send police out and maybe use me as an object lesson. I really wasn't sure. So I called our very own Jim Skinner on my speed dial. Elected Collin County Sheriff. I believe another righteous elected official. Another legitimate authority. And I said, Jim, I'm scared. He goes, no one's arresting my pastor on my watch. I said, okay, I feel a little better. I've got God, most importantly, and I've got Jim Skinner on my side. So anyway, I was afraid. I got to be honest with you, if I can be direct. I was terrified when I would watch the news and I would see the judge in Dallas being different than the county judge we had out here. It's just, you know, I was thinking, man, it'd be horrible if we had any of our churches in Dallas. I mean, they were terrorizing pastors and putting these artificial limits on them and threatening arrest. And I got to be honest, I'm terrified of illegitimate authority. You know why? Because ultimately that authority doesn't come from God. It comes from whom? It comes from Satan. And by the way, if you hadn't noticed, Satan is pretty powerful. Now, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. We have Jesus. We have the Holy Spirit in us. So, look, legitimate authority, look at that third point, praises good behavior and condemns evil behavior. Okay, so anybody remember BLM and Antifa burning down America, shooting police officers, tearing down buildings, burning, looting? Do you remember that? You're like, please, I want to forget it. So do I. But it's an illustration. Illegitimate authority praises evil behavior and condemns good behavior. Okay. Anybody else, the light bulb really coming on and it's burning pretty bright right now? Legitimate authority is a minister of God for good. Illegitimate authority is a minister of Satan for evil. It's either coming from God or it's coming from Satan, the authority. Legitimate authority punishes evil. Illegitimate authority punishes good. Does anybody else believe, I'm talking about non-whack job, insane person, just level-headed, does anybody believe we have two separate standards for justice in our country right now? Does anybody else? You see, there's a problem. In the words, was it Shakespeare? There's something rotten in Denmark. Is that from, no? Ham? Yeah. Okay. That's my English major daughter. So there's something rotten in Denmark. So the point is, there's something rotten. We have to, as Christians, as pursuers of righteousness, we have to take God's word and humbly, but boldly, the best we know how, we have to say, God defines, Mr. Elected Official. God defines the bounds of your authority. And whether you are exercising legitimate authority or you are exercising illegitimate authority. How many of you would say that it was an illegitimate authority for Hitler to murder 6 million Jews? How many of you would agree that every one of those who were ready? Well, I'm just a man under authority who went along with it. How many of you believe that was actually an evil action, not resisting the evil, illegitimate authority? See, I think it's the worst kind of evil. It's a passive, fear-filled, non-courageous response. It's, I don't want them coming after me. so I'm not going to resist. So let me tell you a true story, and I know my kids have heard this, and I love my dad, and just pray he'll be with us longer. I love him. He's a great warrior. And my dad had one or two health spas in Birmingham, Alabama in the early 60s. Now, does anybody kind of know where this is going? You think you know where it's going? Yeah, you know where it's going. There was a corrupt person in power over law enforcement in Birmingham, that area, and he was, to put it plainly, he was a racist. He was filled with hate. He was terrorizing people for only one reason, because they had more melanin in their skin. How many of you would agree with me that's vile and that's wicked? It is, isn't it? So my dad had multiple employees. Some of his employees happened to have more melanin in their skin. They worked for him, he paid them, he treated them with dignity and respect because they're created equal before God. And my dad actually was a strong Christian man and a deacon in his church. And so he sends his employee to go get some rubbing alcohol for the masseuse for my dad's spa. And in those days, you had to have a letter from your employer given to the person with a higher level of melanin in their skin for them to have permission, like a little school kid, to go do something, you know. And there was a certain side of the road, too, that they would walk on, people with more melanin. Evil, 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 agreed? So anyway, his guy went out, and there was nowhere he could walk without getting hit by cars, so he had to walk on the wrong side of the road by these evil, illegitimate authority laws. And so he gets up there, and he's making his way down to get the rubbing alcohol, and a police officer sees him, and comes running after him with we have law enforcement here. What do you call, is it a billy stick? A club, a baton? I thought they were billy sticks, I don't know why. Maybe they hit you in the belly. No, but anyway, he starts beating on my dad's employee. And so he takes off, my dad's employee takes off running, knowing that the only one that's there to protect him would be my dad, who happened to be very, very, very strong. Huge, muscly guy. And he runs to him, and I think it was up on the second floor. The policeman's running behind his employee, beating him with the baton, or whatever they call it. And my dad, his employee's screaming, so my dad comes out and places his rather muscular body between his employee and this illegitimate authority. And the guy commands my dad to move, and my dad said, I will move, but you've got to stop hitting so-and-so. And so he said, okay, all right. So he lied, and as soon as my dad moved out of the way, he started beating him again. So my dad stepped in, grabbed the man, slammed him against the wall, took his baton, whatever, and next thing you know, the head guy, the corrupt guy that's over all of law enforcement that for that area, called my dad in and basically threatened my dad for getting disobeying laws or whatever. And my dad gave a very passionate plea for righteousness. If you want to know where any fight I got, that's from my dad. And he gave this beautiful speech. I wish it had been recorded, but he relayed it to us. And anyway, the long and short of it was my dad was a powerful businessman in the area, and he had his lawyer present, and this corrupt person couldn't do anything against my dad. But let me explain something. authority, real authority, legitimate authority, comes from God. Let's be very clear about something. We need police officers. If you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
So what we need is the very small percentage of police officers who are whack jobs, who are megalomaniacs, who are not operating in the realm of legitimate authority, right? Weed them out, punish them, amen? And empower the good, righteous police officers to do what God ordained that institution, that sphere of authority to do. Doesn't it seem simple to us as Christians? But make no mistake, so increasingly, here's our problem. Our problem is we are living in a time, if you were honest, as I went through that checklist from Romans chapter verses 13, verses 3 and 4, and where God described what legitimate authority was, and by contrast, what illegitimate authority was, how many of you would be honest enough to say that there are people in the highest levels of authority in our country that absolutely are illegitimate authorities? How many of you be honest enough to say that? Yeah. So I'm saying to you, we need to stand against, we need to resist authorities, illegitimate authorities. We need to submit to the legitimate ones. I'm going to reinforce the submission thing, because I don't want anybody leaving here that's just a whack job, like some guy brings a nail gun and a rifle to an FBI office out in the middle of nowhere. Why do you bring a nail gun? You're not all there. You know what I mean? And anyway, that doesn't represent you and me. Amen? That's not who we are. And so look at the third point. God wants us to obey legitimate authority, not only to avoid punishment, but for conscience' sake. This is critical. Verse 5, therefore it is necessary to be in subjection, not only because of wrath, but also for conscience' sake. So let me give you an example. I don't like it that when they put a four-lane divided road out in front of my house. It used to be a two-lane. It was 55 miles an hour when it was a two-lane. I like that. I could get into town quicker. Now it's a four-lane concrete road divided, all safe, and it's 45 miles an hour. Guess what? I want you to ask me, Pastor Jeff, how fast do you go on that road? I go 43 to 45 miles an hour, and I'll tell you why. I do it for conscience' sake. Because the established authorities for this area have set the speed limit at 45 miles an hour. I don't like it. I don't like it at all, but I'm going to obey it for conscience' sake. There are some places where it should be a yield sign instead of a stop sign. Anybody agree in your area? It's not just mine, right? But let me tell you something. I stop. Ask my wife. I don't scooch right on through. I don't look around to see if the county sheriff deputy's out there or that, you know. I don't. You know why? Because God's watching. In other words, I obey for conscience' sake. And I know I just lost about 60% of you because you know. I've seen you flying by me at 70 in the 45. Be careful. The legitimate authority does not bear the ticket in vain. And he will get you, or she will get you. We're to obey the legitimate authority, not only to avoid punishment, for conscience' sake. Look, in the Old Testament, Aaron and Miriam spoke against Moses' legitimate authority, and what happened to Miriam? She became leprous, you remember? And then Moses pleaded for her life, and the Lord said, okay, she'll just have leprosy 1 week, but you shame her and put her out of the camp because she defied Moses' legitimate authority. God is for legitimate authority. God wants to obey legitimate authority. The founding fathers listened heavily to the Reverend Dr. Mayhew. Hey, that'd be pretty good, Landon, the Reverend Doctor. This guy was ordained, but he also had a doctor's degree. The Reverend Dr. Mayhew preached a bunch of sermons from the Word of God about this whole topic of legitimate and illegitimate authority. And the founding fathers listened to him. And other pastors were preaching these godly sermons. And the next thing you know, they came up with a motto from his sermons. Listen to this. This came from the Reverend Dr. Mayhew's sermons. Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God. Anybody familiar with that phrase? Good, because I mentioned it last week. But it's a good one. I wanted to repeat it. Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God. Now, look at the fourth point. God wants us to resist illegitimate authority for conscience' sake and realize this will most likely bring persecution. So now we're going to use the scripture again. That's our authority. In Acts 4, 18 through 21, Peter and John were preaching the gospel. They were healing the sick. And what happened? They got arrested. Peter, look at verse 19. But Peter and John answered and said to them, "Whether it's right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than to God, you be the judge. For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard." When they had threatened them further, they let them go, finding no basis on which to punish them on account of the people, because they were all glorifying God for what had happened. Did Peter and John submit or obey those illegitimate authorities at that moment? Did they resist or obey? They resisted. They said, "We can't obey you. We got to obey God, because God's the highest authority. And all true authority comes from God. And if your authority is from God, you wouldn't be asking us to go against God and what God's commanded." Exodus 16, Dathan, Abiram, and Korah exercised illegitimate authority. They were leaders. They were definitely leaders in Israel, but they exercised illegitimate authority. And what did God do to them? Did God like that? No, God took them out. I think there was involved fire and the ground opening up. Sodom and Gomorrah. Were those leaders of those towns, cities, the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, were those leaders exercising legitimate or illegitimate authority? It was illegitimate. I mean, the leaders themselves were coming to Lot's house, breaking down the door to be involved, some horrible, horrible activity with the two angels that appeared like men. We want to know them. And that's all I'm going to say. If you read it, you'll know what that means. But that was illegitimate authority. And how did God view that illegitimate authority? We see God took out Sodom, took out Gomorrah, fire and brimstone came down. Look at chapter 5, verses 17 and 18 and beyond. But the high priest, now this is the apostles, okay, y'all? This is the apostles. And they're preaching Jesus, they're healing the sick. But the high priest rose up along with all his associates. That's the sect of the Sadducees. They were all filled with jealousy. They didn't like it. The apostles could draw bigger crowds. They laid hands on the apostles. They put them in jail, public jail. When they had brought them there, they stood before the council, and the high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name." What name is that, congregation? The name of Jesus. "And yet you have filled Jerusalem with all your teaching and intend to bring this man's blood upon us." But Peter and the apostles answer, "We must obey God rather than man." What are they doing? Are they obeying the government? By the way, the high priest and that council, they were not only religious leaders, but they were the governing officials for Israel of the day. Did they obey them or did they resist them? They resisted. They disobeyed. We must obey God rather than man. They took his advice. So basically what the high priest wanted to do, the illegitimate authority, the council, the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of the day wanted to do, is they wanted to murder the men. They wanted to kill the men. And Gamaliel was a voice of reason. And he said, wait a second. He talked them out of doing that. So let's pick it up. So look at verse 40. So they took his advice, Gamaliel's advice, and after calling the apostles in, they flogged them. They beat them, in other words. Ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus, then released them. Now listen, what was their response? Did they obey the illegitimate authorities, or did they disobey or resist? They disobeyed, they resisted. So then they went their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they kept right on teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. In Acts 6, 8 through 12, Stephen was preaching Jesus. He was full of faith. He was full of the Holy Spirit. And some cruddy characters, some men, tried to oppose him. Stephen just shredded them to pieces with loving truth. They couldn't answer him. So these guys raised up corrupt witnesses. Sounds like what we see in our country right now, right? And raised up corrupt witnesses. But they were unable to cope with the wisdom. Okay, then they secretly induced men to say, we've heard them speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. They stirred up the people. They dragged them away. They brought them before the council, before the governing officials. And chapter 7, verses 51 through 60, we find the culmination of this illegitimate authority arresting God's anointed one, Stephen. You men, look at verse 51. After Stephen bought himself some time by going through a history of Israel, what did he do? He said, you men are stiff-necked. You are uncircumcised in heart and ears. You're always resisting the Holy Spirit. You're doing just like your fathers did when one of the prophets did your fathers not persecute. They killed those who had previously announced the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you have now become. What is he calling the elected, illegitimate authority? Not elected, excuse me. That's our form of government. What was he calling the authorities that were being illegitimate in the expression of that authority of the day? He said, you guys are stiff-necked. You're uncircumcised in your heart. That's a tough thing to say to a Jewish person. And you are essentially involved in your betrayers, your murderers. You murdered the Son of God. And they got so mad at him. They got so mad, they gnashed their teeth and they began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their garments at the feet of whom? Of Saul. And what I really like is the last words out of his mouth. He said, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. The very ones that were exercising illegitimate authority over him, the ones that had just taken his life, his last breath, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. He had love in his heart, even for these people that were setting themselves up as his enemies and killing him. In chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, it just talks about persecution spread. All right. The book of Judges. Anybody read the book of Judges in the Old Testament? Isn't that a cool book? Don't read it to your 7-year-old child before they go to bed. Now, maybe by the time they're 8, they can handle it. But Samson was one of the judges. One of my favorite is Ehud. Anybody know about Ehud? What did Ehud do? God instructed a series of judges to resist, to rebel against illegitimate authority over Israel. And so what Ehud did is he fabricated a sword. He was a left-handed dude. And he ended up hiding it and telling the king, you know, I've got a special word for you or something, the illegitimate authority. And he came in, and everybody left the room. And does anybody remember what happened? The guy was so fat, he stabbed him in the stomach. It was like an 18-inch, you know, little dagger sword thing. And the guy was so fat, says refuse came out, and his fat covered over the sword. I see some of the ladies going. It is nasty, isn't it? And it kind of sounds brutal, right? But I will tell you very clearly, the entire book of Judges is about resistance to illegitimate, non-God-blessed authority. Now, I'm not advocating that you fabricate an 18-inch sword. Let me be clear. I am not advocating that you fabricate an 18-inch sword and go, well, hey, who did it? I'll go out and do it. I absolutely, fundamentally reject that idea for our form of government that we have in our country. Let your anger, your righteous anger, focus you in a very positive way. And I want to, in a moment, very briefly wrap up the sermon with what I think we can do as American citizens, but most importantly, as citizens of heaven, in appropriate, godly, biblical response to illegitimate authority. So, if the state presumes to forbid what God commands, or commands what God forbids, the state has moved beyond its sphere of authority. Do you believe that? The reformers came to reject the unbiblical doctrine of the divine right of kings. Anybody read about that? James I, James II. Essentially what it said was, the king is just like God in your midst, and there's never a time to resist the authority of the king. There's no instance where you can resist the king. If you resist the king, you're resisting God. How many of you believe, I mean, is that scriptural? So I'm going to argue that whenever you're talking human authorities, whether you're talking about in the church, you're talking about civil authorities, or you're talking about any sphere of authority, I listed family authority, civil authority, and church authority, all human authority, whenever you're talking about human authority, is qualified. But when you're talking about God's direct authority, it's unqualified. Do you agree with that? That's really important. Otherwise, you're susceptible to a Jim Jones or that wacko from Waco, David Koresh. If you don't see men who are exercising authority as defining that authority they exercise the way God defines legitimate authority and the way God defines illegitimate authority, if you don't look at it from that perspective, what happens is we're really messed up, bad. So, man's authority is always qualified. God's authority is unqualified. Last page in your notes. What are some current examples of Christian resisting illegitimate authority? Christian teachers in the public school told to use personal pronouns of a child's choice even when it goes against the truth. You think it's good for that Christian teacher to resist that? I do, because you can't tell a lie. Christians being forced to get the experimental vaccine in order to keep their governmental job or to keep from being kicked out of the military. I forgot to give y'all some great news at the beginning. I gotta give it to you right now, it'll fit right in. Company to pay millions to employees over denying religious exemptions to COVID-19 shots. 10 million to be exact. Anybody happy about that? Isn't that good? They were terrorizing people. Oh, here's another one. Federal judge blocks Biden administration's guidance allowing biological males in girls' school bathrooms. The judge ruled the administration misquoted the Supreme Court. Anybody excited about that? Christian bakers, florists, web designers, Christian photographers being fined or shut down for not promoting the homosexual agenda. That's an example of Christians resisting illegitimate authority. Christian parents being bullied by the Justice Department, called domestic terrorists for objecting to school boards allowing CRT, that's critical race theory, and drag queens to read to small children in libraries, etc. Being called by our Justice Department domestic terrorist, that's bullying. That's illegitimate authority. That's way beyond what God intended. Christian coach Joseph Kennedy fired for taking a knee alone after a football game and praying a silent prayer. Did y'all know the Supreme Court vindicated him? Amen. That's another bit of good news. Okay, this is the last example I'll give of current examples of Christians resisting a legitimate authority. But you know, there were quite a few pastors that were arrested and churches that were fined for not shutting down during the pandemic. Did you know that? A lot of them were in California, but they were in some other states as well. We know they were doing it in Canada big time, but I'm talking about our country. All right, so in conclusion, this is it. How do we navigate through the current minefield of lawlessness and illegitimate authority? Peter answers this in 1 Peter 2:16 and 17. Look what he writes. And I need y'all to underline it, please. This is so important. Act as free men, the Apostle Peter says. Act as free men. You are free. Act free. And do not use your freedom, though, as a covering for evil, but use it as bond slaves of God. Honor all people. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. Our default as Christians should be to show respect to our elected officials. If we cannot show due honor to the elected official themselves, and we have a lot of situations where we can't, then let's default. Never, ever stop showing honor for that sphere of authority, for that office of, fill in the blank. Amen? That's important for the rule of law, because that office, that sphere of authority is from God, and we need proper, legitimate, God-blessed spheres of authority. Okay, for me, I want to keep the main thing, and I'm hoping for you, by the way, I want to keep the main thing of sharing the gospel of Jesus. I want Jesus Christ to be lifted up. I want most of what people are hearing come out of my mouth is that I want them to experience a relationship with the God of the universe through faith in Jesus Christ. Amen? I want us to keep the main thing individually. I want to keep the main thing for our church. We want to lead people to become fully devoted followers. You ready? Not of a political party. Can I speak candidly? I'm going to be honest. You can't trust the Republican Party. You can't trust the Democratic Party. You can't trust the Independent Party. I'm making those statements. Your ultimate trust is in the Lord. Are there trustworthy people? Are there trustworthy people in politics? You bet you. And we need to pray for them and we need to support them, don't we? Okay, but listen, for me, I do want to keep that main thing the main thing. I want to be known as genuinely loving and fiercely committed to God's truth. That's my hunger, my passion in this, and my final, whatever this is, whatever time God gives me to lead and love, I don't want to ever separate love and truth. That's where we are in our country right now. Most of the churches are just, oh, we love people. Let's do so many random acts of kindness. But, wow, yeah, amen. But why would we ever separate from those loving acts that come from God himself? Why would we ever separate that from the truth, the gospel, the good news, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and he's the only one that can meet your needs ultimately? I want to be known as someone who's submissive to God's legitimate authorities and at the same time will fiercely oppose and resist any evil, illegitimate authority. Please hear my heart on it. I want this church known as a church that is these people at Stepping Stones. They obey the legitimate governing authorities. They're good citizens. They're not hotheads. They're not troublemakers. They're people that are submissive to legitimate authority. They're the best citizens. Those Christians over there at Stepping Stones, they're some of the best citizens. And these United States, that's what I'd love for us to be known for, right? But not at the expense of compromising truth. So I want us to be known as a people that are submissive to legitimate authority, but at the same time, I want them to know, I want every elected official to know, I want every bureaucrat to know that they start encroaching in on mine or someone in my congregation's God-given inalienable rights, I'm going to resist them. I'm going to speak out against them. I'm going to oppose them. How many of you believe that's righteous before God? Have you heard enough of the sermon? They need to know the worst thing that could happen. There's a lot of bad things that could happen, but one of the worst things that could happen would be for us as Christians to be seen as these little syrupy, misguided, deluded. We can do anything to those Christians because they're dummies. Those Christians don't know their constitutional rights. Those Christians never stand up. You know, they may talk, but then they don't do anything. They may talk, but they never boycott us. I'm talking about some of the corporations that are doing stupid things. We don't want to be known as that, right? We want to be known as loving people filled with truth and that will fiercely oppose illegitimate authority. I want to be known as someone who is submissive to God's legitimate authority and at times fiercely oppose and resist the legitimate authority. Getting old, I read the same line. May the Lord give each of us through his Holy Spirit, wisdom, and everything we need to be found faithful. Let me be clear about something. I do not believe it is time. I do not identify with or relate to anybody that is talking violent activity against our government. I fundamentally reject it. I believe God's institutions of authority, and I believe that we need to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. We need to be like, I need to be like the pastors were back in the day, the Black Robe Regiment. I need to be that kind of pastor, guys, that we're not idiots, that we're prepared. But I want to be clear. The time is not now. The time is not right now for any kind of uprising like our founding fathers did. It is not right now. It is salt and light, peaceful. Did I say peaceful? This is very important because I know I have people that follow me on social media, and I just want everybody to understand the time is not now. I hope we never face the time like our founding fathers did. But I will tell you, if that time ever comes, I believe a biblically literate congregation will be ready to face that. But we're not there now. We're not there now. You know where we are? And I don't want anybody to be offended. I know the whole politics thing. I'm sorry, but you got to, Christian. It's the way we express our worldview. My hope's not in the Republicans. It's not in the Democrats. It's not in independents. It's not in these politicians. But right now, let me be clear, the highest and most important sphere of authority is the church. I get that, but we're on the top of the double-decker bus. And that civil sphere of authority, that's, you know, the red buses over in London, you've seen them, the double-deckers. So we're on the top, church authority, yeah, Christ ruling and reigning. But on the first floor of the bus, guess who's driving the bus? The one driving the bus is civil authority. So we better impact civil authority in a righteous, positive way, right? Because that's how righteousness will get expressed in our form of government. What do you think about that? Is there a little amen in you at least? Or
amen.
Salt and light. 48% of professing Christians didn't vote in the last presidential election. Did you hear that? I can't comprehend that. I'm not telling you how to vote, but please vote. Please. Please, please. And vote the Bible. Vote your conscience. Vote. Is that too partisan? I don't think so. I hope other pastors are speaking up. I don't want to see 48% of professing Christians not show up again. Or surely, folks, we will lose and we'll whine ourselves into oblivion. So let's do it for the glory of God. Anyway, there's so much that could be said. By the way, if you want to discuss some of this stuff with me, I've got like a stack this high related to this. There's so much. I prayed about it. Two messages, the cap right now on this subject. Next week we'll be talking about, we'll start the book of Revelation, future things. And it's going to be a cool study. And I want everybody to come back, please. But pray. Let's pray for one another, that we can stand up, right? That we can be brave and courageous. Let's stand with one another. All right, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. I preached, I'm so sorry, not literally stand, but let's stand for righteousness, but let's be seated and have a prayer. Oh God, it's amazing that you'll use me. I know you formed Adam out of the dust of the ground, and I'm one of his offspring, so I'm just amazed that you use a piece of dirt for your glory and honor. You have created us, though, in your image and in your likeness, and Lord, we need you. We confess our need for you, and this message today, Lord, I think so important, and give everyone that's heard it the ability to apply it in a way that is needed for their life, even today, and this week, and this month, Lord. But Lord, my heart is pounding the hardest for souls to be saved. And last week we had some that professed faith in you. And I pray today, Lord, if there's anybody here that has not fully surrendered to you, Jesus, you're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus, you are the ultimate authority. All other authorities are subservient to you. And I pray if there's anybody here that doesn't know you personally, that today would be the day they'd put their faith in you alone. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Please, no one looking around. Do you know? Do you know that you know that all your sins are forgiven? Do you know that if you were to die today, you'd go to heaven? If you don't know that for sure, would you please reach out to God? Put your faith in Jesus Christ. The Bible says whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You're a whoever. Just call on him right now. Whether you're watching this on YouTube or Facebook, just call on the Lord. And you will be saved. In calling on him, you're putting your faith and your trust in him alone to forgive you of your sins and to give you eternal life. Will you do that today? You say, Pastor Jeff, I don't know exactly how. Well, you can just pray a prayer of faith. Put it in your own words, but say something like this. Say, Lord Jesus, I know I've sinned. And Jesus, I know my sin separates me from you. Jesus, I need you. Save me. Give me eternal life. Give me your forgiveness. Wash me clean as white as snow. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you just prayed that prayer of faith and you meant it, you called on Jesus, slip up your hand right now. Would you do that? Just raise your hand up. Is there anyone? Okay. God bless you. Put your hand down. Thank you. Is there anyone else? Glory to God. This one that I've seen raising your hand right after the service, would you take a few moments? Give me the privilege just to visit with you, please. Just let me visit with you about your decision to receive Christ. Christians, oh, by the way, church family, thanks for praying for me. I went way over today on the sermon, but did what I believe the Lord wanted me to do. I said what I believe the Lord wanted me to say from his word. Thank you for your prayers. But Christians, what's God saying to you? What is he saying to you? There's got to be something in that message that he wants you to apply to your life. If my brothers and sisters, if you believe God spoke a word to you, maybe it reinforced something in your heart, or maybe it challenged you to in this area or that area. But if you believe God spoke to you, raise your hand right now. Just raise it up. Hands going up all over. Praise God. God, be with my brothers and sisters. Give us all the ability, Lord, to walk in what you've told us, you've spoken to us. May we be loving, 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 courageous Christians during these incredibly difficult times. Continue, Lord, to grow our church in a way that would be honoring to you. It's in the peerless and the matchless name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right, we're going to continue worshiping the Lord with tithes and offerings. Guests, put your guest card in there, would you please? Parents with small children, make sure and thank the beautiful people that were in the nursery during this enormously long sermon today. Make sure and thank them. I am. Amen and amen. A couple of quick announcements. Hey, remember to pray for the kids. This is their first full week back at school for most of them. Let's remember to lift them up in prayer. New sermon series next Sunday, Future Things. Are you ready? Study in the book of Revelation. We'll have a preparedness seminar next Sunday right after church. Some of you, that may scare you when you think about, oh, my church is having a preparedness seminar. It really is for everyone. And I mean, just to prepare for any kind of contingency. It could be a natural disaster, or it could be just anything. But we want to be prepared. And there's going to be some great folks participating in it. Let me just say this. It will not be driven by fear, but by faith. And it would just be a spirit of, be prepared. Let's really be ready. And so that's next Sunday. Everybody's invited. Free lunch. That's nice. RSV online. You can follow the QR code in your bulletin, your worship folder, or you can register at the information table. We want to have plenty of food for everybody and resources for everybody. So please RSVP, but everybody is invited. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet, not metaphorically, but literally now. I'm looking for someone to close us out in prayer. Let's see. We have a deacon in the room. Bob, prayer leader, you come on up. Bob Hyatt, you close us out. I love y'all. Thanks for being so patient with me. I preached 15 minutes longer than normal. That way we didn't have a part three.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the anointed word that you have given Pastor Jeff. May we take it to heart and may we understand each thing that you would have us believe out of that. As we go forth and live our lives during the week, bring us all back safely that we may continue to grow in your word and to love you more. We ask this in Jesus' name.